Good evening, and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California. Tonight's program is presented in partnership with the Lafayette Library and Learning Center's Glenn Seaborg Learning Consortium. You can find the club on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Jeff Greenwald, travel and science writer and moderator for tonight's program. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our very special guest, Mary Roach. Mary and I first met on a press trip to Tahiti in 1995. The entire voyage took place on a boat. I was on a travel assignment for the San Francisco Chronicle. Mary had talked her way into a story for Walking magazine. I knew right away she was crazy. Trying to do a story about walking on a four-masted schooner is like trying to write about synchronized swimming in the Gemini space capsule. Mary's actual coefficient of craziness would emerge over the years as she turned her fearless inquiry toward a seemingly endless variety of subjects, including jousting, knife throwing, riding on a biplane with Tom Cruise, and working as a sniff tester for underarm deodorants. She didn't stop there. As a columnist for Salon.com and later Reader's Digest, Mary was always fascinated by territory where few people dare to tread. This has taken her into the realm of the dead in Stiff, the realm of the undead in Spook, and into white paper gowns at sex research labs in Bonk. And now she takes us into outer space where there's more to be squeamish about than you might think. There is a Yiddish proverb that I love. One should live if only to satisfy one's curiosity. As far as humans go, I think I can safely say that Mary Roach is truly a living specimen, and that being her friend or one of her readers is always a lively enterprise. I'm as grateful for her books as for her friendship, almost. Please welcome again Mary Roach.
Thank you, Jeff. Wow. Well, thanks. Thanks so much for coming here. I'm drinking water because my publicist has been encouraging everybody to serve Tang, and so everywhere I go, I've been drinking Tang, and I realize my colon must be fluorescent by now, so I'm switching to water for a little while. Tang is not, it was not invented by NASA. In fact, Tang is a commercial supermarket product that they just sort of put on the map. NASA buys a lot of things at the supermarket that you don't know about. The diapers that go in the big white suit when they're spacewalking, those are a commercial off-the-shelf product, not a NASA invention. I asked what the brand that they're using is. She said, well, I'm not sure what we're using now, but for quite a while we were using an adult diaper called Rejoice. I don't know. Who names an adult diaper Rejoice? Anyway, my book is... It's not a typical space book. I don't know that there is a typical nonfiction space book, but my sense of them is there tend to be a lot of heroics and triumphs and sometimes tragedies, you know, boldly going and boldly coming back and, you know, Jim Lovell on the way to the moon, explosion, fighting for their lives and all that. I did talk to Jim Lovell, but not about Apollo 13. I interviewed him about Gemini 7, which was an unusual mission. It was the longest mission we had undertaken. It was 2 weeks. And one of the things that they were trying to learn, it was sort of a dress rehearsal for the moon. They were trying to answer the question, what happens to two people in a very small space wearing spacesuits with no shower and no way to bathe? Can you even stand it? I mean, what happens to the skin? This chapter is called Houston, We Have a Fungus. I interviewed Captain Love. He was so nice to speak to me. I think he gets tired of talking about Apollo 13. He was like, oh, Gemini 7, and so we had this interesting conversation about hygiene and things. And I asked him about one of the aspects that when you don't shower, you get a sort of a buildup of exfoliated skin and a little bit of dandruff. Not taking a shower for 2 weeks, and in zero gravity, that doesn't fall to your shoulders. I believe I said, was it just like a snow globe in there? He said, Mary, you're investigating a rather unusual aspect of spaceflight. Anyway, so I did investigate some rather unusual aspects of spaceflight, as is my wont, and we're going to talk about all those unusual aspects of spaceflight, and really any aspect that comes up, whatever you're curious about. I think between Jeff and I, Jeff can name all of the astronauts on all of the missions. He was an unbelievable space geek as a child, and still is. So I think we've pretty much got the entire history of the space program, and everything going on now is covered right up here on stage. So we're going to welcome all your questions, and this will be really fun. So thanks.
Okay, you all geared up?
I'm all geared up.
So let's just start with a basic question here. All of your past books have been about experiences we all share, sex, death, the afterlife. Mm-hmm. With Packing for Mars, you get into territory that very few people on Earth have ever really experienced. Why did you diverge into this sort of surgically small topic of human experience?
I don't think of the book as a departure in that I see all of the books as the human body in unusual circumstances. So, you know, Stiff, you have interesting post-mortem careers. And Spook, it was sort of bringing the soul into the laboratory setting, which is kind of peculiar. And then Bonk was the human body in sex labs, sexual physiological research. Awkward. And so this one is now the human body in zero gravity and in space. To me, it's not a tremendous departure. Mm-hmm. But you're right, it is not. It isn't something everybody... But I think everybody has... I mean, everybody's familiar with the astronaut experience in that they've seen, whether it's Apollo or more recent footage. I mean, it's a kind of a ubiquitous topic, so I think... In a way, we're all a little bit familiar with it.
Yeah, I think we're all familiar with certainly those of us who grew up in the 60s and 70s with how tough it is physically to be an astronaut. One of the things you talk about in the book that I just think is really fascinating is how psychologically fit you have to mm-hmm. be an astronaut, because the upcoming missions to places like Mars will be 500 days or longer.
Right.
So you talk about how in the Japanese training program they have all the astronauts herded together and they have to make like 1,000 origami cranes, and you talk about how the Canadians are obsessed with catastrophe management. What kind of qualities do you think would be the most important qualities for someone who is able to go on a trip in a little sardine can to Mars?
Sure. It's kind of a combination of the original for the Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo programs, where particularly Gemini and Mercury, you really wanted the quote unquote right stuff. You wanted somebody brave, courageous, virile, macho, because you're taking tremendous risks, you're doing things that had never been done before, you're not going up there for very long, a few hours to a few days, mm-hmm. so you wanted this sort of Chuck Yeager, but you know, kind of the John Glenn, Alan Shepard kind of just swaggering, driving around in a Corvair really fast. You wanted the right stuff. And then we move into the space shuttle era, the space station era. We're talking about long missions, from 2 weeks to 6 months or more, at six people. So you don't, the right stuff is now the wrong stuff, because you get a bunch of huge egos like that, and then they'll kill each other. So now you want mm-hmm. kind of you want a nerd.
Right, just like in Star Trek, the original Star Trek was all these kind of blustering guys, but by Star Trek The Next Generation, they had a therapist on board.
Yeah, that's right, an empath, yeah. An empath. Right, right. But for Mars, I think now you're going to need, again, the sort of brave, good leadership skills, fearless in the face of catastrophe, able to function. Because you can't just call, you can't just get on the radio and talk to mm-hmm. mission control, because it's a 20-minute communications lag when you're on the way to Mars. You've got to really figure it out on your own. So now you need a combination of the old Mercury Gemini, you know, macho swaggering guy, and the sensitive sort of Richard Gere and Knights and Rodanthe kind of guy.
So when you say there's a 20-minute lag, I just want to be clear. At the speed of light, it will take radio signals 10 minutes to get to Earth and then 10 minutes to get back to the spacecraft. So that's the 20-minute lag?
It's a 20... When you send a message, mm-hmm. it's a 20 minutes before you get an answer. My understanding is that unless it's 20 minutes... No, it's 20 minutes before you get a reply.
Wow.
Yeah.
So it's hard to have an argument.
So, yes, I think it probably a lot of time built in for, you know, cooling down and being a little, I think that should be a form of therapy. Just build in a 20-minute delay.
It's true. Sometimes even a 5-second delay does the trick. You talk to a lot of astronauts and cosmonauts in this book. Were they from all eras of the space program, from the Mercury on through the Apollo to the ISS?
I spoke to some cosmonauts from way back in the 60s, and I actually one of them from the was with Yuri Gagarin in the first group of cosmonauts, and then some from Mir, and then the current space shuttle ISS, and Gemini too.
Gemini. So most of them would. Did you feel that there was any sort of temperamental difference between cosmonauts and astronauts?
Oh, God, yes. Yes, absolutely. The cosmonauts, well, you not only could you talk about anything, and they enjoyed it. I mean, I would have these wonderful conversations about sex and death and really anything you brought up. I talked to Alexander Levake and his partner, Yuri Romanenko. There were two of them on 6 months on Mir. Ended up with some psychological issues, and I thought it would be interesting to bring them into, there's a mock-up of Mir at the Museum of Cosmonautics, so I brought them in and had them sit at their little places in at the controls and asked them about how they got along. And Levakin in particular was very candid. He talked about how space is a very frustrating place. I mean, you're stuck, you can't really control your environment, you can't slam the door and go for a drive. So it's you get frustrated. Frustration turns to anger, and anger wants an outlet. And you kind of have three outlets in space. You have, you can take it out on each other, which is ill-advisable when you're depending for your survival on your crewmates. So what they tend to do is what the space psychiatrists call displacement, which is you get really, really irritable with mission control. or in Jim Lovell's case, it was the nutritionist. He was constantly getting on the radio and going, "Memo to Dr. Chance, I have chicken a la king, serial number 64A212, cannot even squeeze contents through opening. At $300 a meal, I think you can do better." And this is all in the mission transcripts. And then he comes back on the line like 2 minutes later, "Continuing memo to Dr. Chance, chicken a la king all over window at this time."
So, $300 a meal, it might as well be the French Laundry.
Yeah, exactly. Might as well be. Yeah.
This thing about people sort of getting along in space and what happens if they don't brings up one of the questions that somebody asked. How would things like, let's say there was a medical emergency in space or something where somebody went nuts. Has anyone actually gone nuts in space?
There's a rumor, and I don't know if it's true, that somebody tried to open a window. On a shuttle era, the hatches are locked because the hatches open out to the it's like it's not that hard to do. No, it opens in, so it's not that hard to do it. And so there's been a lock put on because of some incident where somebody supposedly kind of lost it and wanted to. There's also the famous diaper-wearing astronaut. I mean, that was pretty much a breakdown.
Right here on Earth.
If you read an amazing book, Diary of a Cosmonaut, 211 Days in Space, the subtitle really says it all. There's a long section of the book where the two guys, this is on Salyut, the early Soviet space station, just not even speaking, just ignoring each other completely.
In a space the size of...
In a Greyhound bus. Yeah.
But what if there was a medical emergency? What if somebody actually, you know, got a gash in their finger, they needed stitches, or broke a bone? How would they deal with that on a Mars mission?
They simulate everything here. Mm-hmm. They'll do emergency procedures on the zero gravity plane. This is a plane that flies these parabolic arcs like this, goes out. They fly out over the Gulf of Mexico and go like way up and then over the top and down. And as the plane goes over and down, you have about 22 seconds of zero gravity. So they will try things like doing stitches or there was someone who was telling me about this instance where the astronauts were learning to draw blood in zero gravity. Mm-hmm. And there was a volunteer, some poor guy who you know was like, "I'll do it. I want to fly on the zero gravity plane." So, and he's strapped into a seat with his arms like this so they can practice on him. And he gets sick and someone else has to hold the bag. Can you imagine? So anyway, they rehearse this stuff. They figure out ways to, because, you know, anything you do here on with gravity, you can't do it the same way. And it's going to be incredibly complicated and tricky. So they will practice procedures as much mm-hmm. as they can, like suturing or, you know, drawing blood. For a Mars mission, they would, of course, have somebody who's emergency medical.
On board.
Yes.
Because with a 20-minute delay, it's
Yeah. They can do telemedicine. They can send, you know, they could send ultrasound. They mm-hmm. can really, when I was up on Devon Island, where they do a lot of simulations for when we thought we were going back to the moon, and for Mars, they'll have a video cam. And so there's a surgeon somewhere down in the lower 48 who's advising the physician up there and practicing doing it by having somebody sort of watch or train and you can be, you know, sending the actual medical CTs mm-hmm. or ultrasound. You could be sending it back and forth. So, but the other thing I heard interesting for a Mars mission, there's actually documentation at NASA where they've had discussions about how they would remove any extraneous organs before you would go, like an appendix. It would be a prophylactic removal of any extraneous.
Also saves on weight.
Saves on weight. That's right. Less to launch. Yeah, yeah. But they would, and even talk. One of them was talking about removing ovaries in a postmenopausal woman, just to, like, anything that might go wrong, try to get rid of it.
Who needs that extra kidney?
Yeah, that's right. One kidney should do, yeah.
Here's an interesting, it's an interesting question to me. I know all firefighters are trained in, they're basically EMTs. Are all astronauts also EMTs?
Not that I know of, no.
I would think that they would want to be a firefighter.
I would imagine that they all are trained in CPR.
Yeah.
But I don't know that they have a full, I don't think they have a full, like, EMT training. But, you know, in the shuttle era, you know, it's not, you really just sort of, you can be getting advice, you can doing mm-hmm. sort of first aid measures, and then you would come back to Earth as soon as you could.
For a Mars mission, the requirements would be a lot more stringent, probably.
Oh, for sure. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. You know, one thing that's not really a medical emergency or even necessarily craziness that I love growing up, having grown up in that era, as I think Mary did too,
was
the whole thing about the idea of rapture of space.
Yes.
The idea that astronauts could just go a little bit loony floating out there in the void. And this actually happened on Gemini 4.
Yes.
With Ed White outside the capsule, and he didn't want to come back in.
No, this is the first American spacewalker, the first person to go outside the capsule attached by an umbilical and floating free, you know, traveling, 17,000 miles per hour, but floating free in space. And the worry was, there was a concern that it would just blow your mind and that you might go nuts and do something rash. But both he and Alexei Leonov, the first person to walk in space, mm-hmm. were both just so enchanted. There's this wonderful, you read the mission transcript from that mission. And first of all, they couldn't get him back in. He kept saying, yeah,
just give me five more minutes.
Just, I've got a great shot with my camera here. Wait a minute. And they go, Ed, you've got to come back in now. Ed, no. Oh, I've got a perfect shot. Just hang on. I'm going to take two more shots. Ed, get back in here. And then finally he agrees and he says, this is the saddest moment of my entire life.
What's weird to me is that it hasn't come up again. Like in 1984, astronaut Bruce McCandless went for not only a spacewalk, but an untethered spacewalk.
Oh, yeah.
He had his little jetpack, and for 5 hours, he was flying around the International Space Station.
There's a photograph in the book
of him doing that.
Yeah, just this backpack where he's got little thrusters.
But no one else has ever gotten that kind of sense of rapture where they... McCandless could have just kept going.
The grew out of the early days. It was like high-altitude solo jet pilots mm-hmm. would sometimes get something called the breakaway effect, where they'd say, there's this paper I found in the Journal of Aviation Medicine, they'd say, you know, there'd be these reports where the pilot would be on the, communicating in his headset saying, I feel like a king. I feel like a god. I feel like I could fly on and on. And there was this fear that they would, that at some point they'd just sort of go crazy and steer off into the point where the altitude is, the air is so thin that they would, you know, get into trouble. So they were really worried about mm-hmm. the astronauts. But I love the, after White finally gets, and White couldn't get through the hatch. It was a 25-minute struggle to get him back in the capsule. It was pretty scary. Anyway, but then they're back in and they're talking about it. And these are just two Air Force guys, you know, two real macho guy dudes. And it's, who's the other guy? McDivitt is the other, his crewmate. And they had this conversation. They sounded like a 70s encounter group. McDivitt goes, Ed White says, I felt so natural out there. And McDivitt goes, yeah, it's like you're back in your mother's womb.
Very well. You know, you write a lot about the astronauts. Let me just ask another question that's up here. You write a lot about the astronauts and very candid things that they've told you. Have you had any feedback yet from the astronauts about what they think about packing for Mars?
I have. Let's see. Well, I sent it to Jim Lovell, and I haven't heard anything. I don't know if he's read it. And of course, the cosmonauts. I haven't. You know, they. I was working with an interpreter. I don't think they read English that well. Oh, they probably could read most of it, but I have two Mike Mullane and Roger Crouch have bought it, but haven't read it yet. So I don't know. I haven't gotten that much feedback from them yet.
You will.
Yes.
Let me get to another question from the audience, which it sort of relates to the whole sanity question. And the question is, what's it like to sleep in space? How do you actually sleep? I mean, you know, my image of sleep, we all think about it, and you crawl under the covers and close your eyes and, you know, dream of sheep, but or whatever.
Right. Yes.
But how do astronauts sleep in space? They actually get a good night's sleep?
Well, they kind of bivouac. They've got a little sleeping sack that's hooked to the wall because you could just sort of close your eyes and it's very comfortable. Zero gravity is just immensely comfortable. And you don't normally, when you wake up in the middle of the night, often it's because you're sleeping funny and your neck is crooked or your hand falls asleep or something wakes you up physical. So they have none of that. So you can really get a good night's sleep, but it's so unusual to not have your head against a pillow. Sometimes they'll like strap a pillow. And sometimes like your arm will float up and hit you in the face. So it can be, they find it sort of discombobulating.
Have any astronauts ever told you their dreams in space?
Do you start to dream in weightlessness? And yeah, so it's sort of like learning a foreign language and having that experience where the first time you dream in a foreign language, there's that point where you start to dream in zero gravity, that you're floating and not walking.
Not falling.
No, not falling, no, floating.
Because as you say in your book, being in zero gravity in orbit around the Earth, you actually are falling.
You are, yes, slowly, you feel like you're floating, but you're falling. Mm-hmm. It's though somebody threw you up so high and far that when you came back down, you missed the edge of the Earth. You literally miss, and you keep falling, but the Earth is pulling you back, so you end up in a orbital pattern.
Spiral, yeah. In a long spiral. So you went up in one of the C9 flights,
yes,
also dubbed the Vomit Comet, unpopularly with NASA.
Yes, they prefer that you call it the Weightless Wonder.
The Weightless Wonder. And you did 30 parabolas, in which for each one you had 22 seconds of weightlessness. And then you have a really wonderful line in your book where you say, it's an indescribable sense of being freed from something you did not realize was there.
Yes, you have that. You go through life with this sensation of the weight of your organs inside you. You know, your heart is hanging on your aorta and your uterus rests on your stomach or your liver, I forget which, and you know, your arms are hanging off your shoulders, and all of that disappears because nothing weighs anything. And it is this weird sort of physical euphoria. You just, if you're not throwing up, it is the greatest experience you can imagine. It's either the greatest thing or the most horrible thing, depending on whether or not the drugs worked out for you.
Wow. Now, you know, you're well aware of the experiment that's being done with the Mars simulation, the 500 days, and the little sort of
modules,
the mock-up. Do you think that's going to actually teach us anything useful about one of those missions? This is actually one of the questions that I'm.
Yeah. Well. I interviewed. There was a mission. There was a similar mock-up. It was done in the same set of modules. It's in Moscow, the Institute for Biomedical Problems. And they have these. It's a simulated sleeping quarter, and then there's three or four parts to it. And people are locked up in there for the hatch is shut, and you are in there for months at a time. And I interviewed a bunch of people who had been there in 1999. I interviewed the U.S. team leader, and that one they There was a fist fight. There was someone smuggled in alcohol on the Millennium Eve. There was a little more drinking than there was supposed to be. There ended up being a fist fight. The Russian commander tried to kiss this Canadian woman, pushed her out of range of the camera. She claimed sexual harassment. The Japanese guy quit because the Russians were watching too much porn. And it was this tremendous mess. There was head lice. The food was terrible. But the psychologists were all going, this is really great stuff. Because that's what they were trying to, it was a study of cross-cultural issue, you know, crews with people from different cultural backgrounds. Mm-hmm. I mean, but the stuff that they're learning is pretty basic. Make sure everybody speaks the same language. That was a problem because the Russians and the Americans didn't, and the Europeans didn't speak much Russian. The Russians mm-hmm. didn't speak much English. Nobody gave sort of a... kind of a basic primer on etiquette and things like if a Russian guy kisses you at a party, don't say no because that means maybe just slap him, you know, right. And then everything would have been okay. But so there was a lot of cross-cultural misunderstandings. And the thing with the Mars mission, the crew would be training together here on Earth for at least a year, probably more. So that mm-hmm. stuff would probably be worked out.
And it's tough.
They go.
I mean, you describe it in your book. I think it's one of the cosmonauts describes it, that it's nothing like you would imagine confinement would be, because I think one of your cosmonauts says, imagine spending a week just locked in your car.
Yeah.
And all you have is the smell of plastic, the smell of rubber
paint. Yeah.
Now, then imagine that for
yeah.
500
yeah, he's, exactly.
days.
Yeah, he said when we got on board, he said it was so much harder and hotter and dirtier than I could imagine, and I turned to Yuri and I said, my God, we will be here for 6 months. And Yuri said, Sasha, people spend 10 years in prison. You can do this. I'm like, you know, it's just...
Not quite the glamorous yeah. vision of space flight we have.
That's right.
A lot of the glamour really goes out the window in this book. I mean, that's I have to say, I'm a little sorry for letting go of that, because I always had this sense of... space travel being so glamorous, but...
But you know what? I think it still is. I mean, I look at it, it's like, I like backpacking. And mm-hmm. and for a lot of people, you describe backpacking, or they what they think of backpacking, like, my God, you're sleeping on a hard ground, you don't have a toilet, you're crapping in the woods, you can't bring coffee, you've got to give up so much. Why in God's name would you spend your vacation like this? And to me, it's just so obvious, because once you get there, the things that you see and the fact that so few people have been there, it's just this amazing experience that, I imagine, you know, that to the nth degree for space. I mean, yes, it's inconvenient. You have restricted hygiene. You can't bring up the things that you want. But my God, look at what you get to see and what you get to experience. So I think that the sort of romance of it is still there. To me, what is incredible is... If you're an astronaut, like less than 1% of your career is spent in space. You're spending your time training on committees, talking to schools and Rotary clubs, working on spacecraft issues. So that's where it starts to fall apart for me.
It's just kind of like a desk job.
You're flying a desk.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. The Chris Hadfield, an astronaut I interviewed, said, yeah, you know, that's what we do. We do the meetings and the training. He said, I've been an astronaut for 6 years, and I've been in space 8 days. So,
let me take a little break here to say, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. We're talking with New York Times bestselling author Mary Roach about her new book, Packing for Mars: The Curious Science of Life in the Void. Let me go back to these questions from the audience and ask you one from here. It's a question about the newspaper today, which shows you, it seems to show you in a spacesuit on the cover of the Contra Costa Times. Is that, the writer asks, is that a real spacesuit?
That is a real cardboard cutout of a spacesuit with a hole where you stick your head through. That was at SETICON, which is the conference put on by the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. So that they had that set up in the one of the rooms there. So no, sadly, I've never worn a spacesuit.
Well, here's a question that has to do with that. Let's get on this just a little bit. The whole question of weightlessness. Now, before any living being had ever been in zero gravity, back in the 1950s, there were all kinds of really kind of, well, strange ideas and fears about what might happen to human body if it was made weightless.
Yes.
And for this, they needed a living subject to test it on, and they tested, of course, on dogs and monkeys. What were some of the things they were afraid would happen to a human body that was in a weightless condition? Like, what could happen besides floating?
They were, you have to bear in mind, gravity, it's one of the fundamental forces of the universe, and the idea of taking that away.
Mm-hmm.
No one had been up there. Nobody knew what would happen. There was fears that the heart wouldn't be able to circulate the blood, that the blood would sort of churn in place without like the resistance of gravity. People feared that the eyeball would change shape and the pilot would be sort of incapacitated because his focus would be so far off that everything would be fuzzy. They were afraid that that the blood might not coagulate. They were concerned that the vestibular system, because you have these little bones, little tiny calcifications in your inner ear, and normally those are resting on the bottom of the inner ear. In zero gravity, they're floating and they're pinging around, which does make you feel nauseous. But they didn't. They thought it would create this just complete incapacitation. They had no idea. So they started out by sending up, it was 1949, Albert won. A little rhesus monkey on the end of a big rocket, mm-hmm. just to wire him up for. He was anesthetized, but he was heart rate and blood pressure, breathing. It was like just sort of putting him up. Yeah, seems like he's still alive. There was this era of tremendous hand wringing, not just the physical stuff, but we were talking about before this the psychological. What will happen? Will the person just lose their mind?
Yeah.
This went on for years. And they started doing the testing on the parabolic flights where they'd have like 22 seconds of zero gravity, and so they would be doing these papers like testing whether or not the initialization of micturition, could you pee, swallowing, could you eat, or would the pieces of food float up the back of the pharynx and into the nose, and would you choke? There was. Just you name it.
Legitimate questions.
Really. Nobody knew if would peristalsis work? Would you be able to swallow, or did you need gravity? And in fact, some of this stuff is. Most of it was fairly minor. But there's things like the human bladder. The way that you know that it's time to go empty it is because there are stretch receptors, and as the fluid fills up on the bottom, it activates these stretch receptors, which triggers your brain and says, hey, go to the loo. Mm-hmm. Well, in zero gravity, you don't have gravity. You've got just surface tension, so the liquid is clinging all around the inside of the organ. So it doesn't trigger mm-hmm. those stretch receptors until the bladder totally is full. So full that it's pressed the urethra shut, and now you need to haul out the self-catheterization kit. So it's actually a really, the astronauts have to kind of be potty trained. They have to be told by the guy. There's a guy. He's the potty trainer at Johnson Space Center. Like, okay, guys, you're going to go to the bathroom every 2 hours, whether you need to or not. It's like a road trip with kids, you know.
So that's amazing. So it's when they have to pee, it's just like urgent.
Yes. No. It's
like
it's
instantly
urgent. It's borderline emergency scenario. Yeah. I mean, I think maybe you become better at detecting a more subtle cue. Probably. You probably learn to deal with it.
Right. Now, someone writes here, do you scuba dive, and how does the experience of weightlessness in space compare to being neutrally buoyant underwater?
Well,
good question.
Yes, neutrally buoyant underwater and scuba diving, almost exactly the same, except the astronauts would be wearing a big pressure suit rather than a scuba suit. Mm-hmm. But how does it compare to weightlessness? I've only scuba dived once. But you have the resistance of water. You feel something buoying you, and you feel the resistance, whereas within zero gravity, you're just like a soap bubble. You're just hanging right here. So it is completely different. I found it to be totally different. It's similar. You would like push off that wall and just sort of fly across the room, which is similar to what you do in a swimming pool, but it without that feeling the water, it's just a tremendously exhilarating thing.
Yeah, it sounds wonderful. You claim to have enjoyed it very much.
I did. I'd love to do it again.
Would you say it was sort of like?
I said that it was like heroin in that I would imagine, in that you hear people say that they'll do it once and like you immediately want to do it again. So it's how I would imagine heroin to be. So there are some reporters who've said, Mary Roach claims that zero gravity feels like taking heroin, which I have no idea.
We're not saying anything like that here, Mary.
No, we're not.
So let's get to the always fascinating subject of space hygiene. And, you know, we think a lot about the astronauts and these Apollo astronauts, three of them in a capsule, splashing down after 2 weeks in space. What we don't think about so much is the frogmen
on the surface
who open the hatch. And basically, it doesn't sound like the best job in the world.
I asked Jim Lovell about that, because after Gemini 7, the restricted hygiene experimental two-week mm-hmm. mission, I said, what was that like for those frogmen? And he's such a gentleman. He started saying, oh, God, they opened the door, and it was like, well, it was very different from the fresh ocean breezes outside. However, elsewhere, I have seen him describe it as like 2 weeks in a latrine.
2 weeks in a latrine.
2 weeks in a latrine, yeah.
There's this thing that some people have that you call anosmia. Am I pronouncing
anosmia,
it right?
Anosmia, yeah.
Anosmia, which is the inability to smell body odor.
Well, you can be anosmic to different smells. But
different smells.
And this is a terrifying fact. You can be anosmic to your own BO. Which mm-hmm. And the guy who was explaining, he's a University of UPenn researcher who has done a lot of work with body odor and dandruff and things like that. I love these guys. Anyway, he... He said that there's people that so do you ever go on an elevator and think, God, how can that person get on this elevator stinking like that? He said, well, they're probably anosmic to their own smell. And he said, and if you've never wondered that on an elevator, you might be one of those people. But yeah, that'd be a good, there was an astronaut attribute would be an anosmia to the smell of BO.
Well, you know, NASA has spent so much money trying to develop foods and the right foods, the right combination everything, every single millimeter of that capsule is micromanaged.
Yeah.
Have they never tried to develop some kind of effective anti-deodorant that would work in a space capsule?
Well, then that itself would have to be sniffed by the official NASA sniffer at the White Sands facility. This guy has sniffed 843 different things that have gone up in space because they want to make sure that because if it off gases, you know, you have it's the same air circulating and the same mm-hmm. chemicals, and so they don't want anything that could be hazardous or just really annoying. This guy has sniffed everything, including, he told me, Sally Ride's tampons. Deodorized and undeodorized, because it all has to be certified. Everything that flies in space has to be certified, and this guy, whose name now escapes me, the sniffer, he's the official nose mm-hmm. of NASA. So an antiperspirant or deodorant, the smell of it would become objectionable. So I think that you have a personal hygiene kit, you can fly stuff. Has to be sniffed.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
I recently learned that the Kindle reader failed the sniff test.
Wow, that's interesting.
They have not flown any Kindles.
Because of off-gassing from the plastic?
Something like that. It didn't pass. It stinks, I guess. I don't know.
Well, obviously, they've got to have some way to refresh the air in these capsules because you can't breathe the same air.
Oh, yes.
For 2 or 3 weeks. How do they actually refresh or recycle the air in a space capsule?
I don't know exactly what the technology is, but they have. Well, it's filtered, and they must freshen it somehow, but there's not, you know, I talked to the cosmonauts about Mir, and they were talking about how the most wonderful thing is when they get a resupply shipment, and sometimes it would contain love letters from women, mm-hmm. and they'd put drops of French perfume, which would never pass at NASA. At NASA, like the sniff test guy would have had a fit, but they talked about how it was so wonderful to smell this French perfume, because, yeah, you're smelling these sort of man-made smells, and you never have, fresh air. Mm-hmm. So
I just get the impression the Soviets didn't have a whole lot of oversight. Like, they could have sent up anything in these letters. Sticks of gum.
Yeah. You know, yeah, I've heard people sneak cigarettes up there. There's one of the cosmonauts showed me a slide, just that I couldn't use his name, but it shows this great, it's like this big, sort of looks like a large hummingbird feeder, a big metal sphere with four straws sticking out and cosmonauts floating all around sucking on the straw. It's cognac.
It was cognac.
It was a 5-liter container of cognac, and they're all sipping straws like they're, you know, teenagers sharing a malt.
Wow, for wonder, I wondered what they were smoking.
Yeah.
Has anyone actually ever had a cigarette in space?
Someone told me that the cosmonauts have snuck cigarettes up. I don't know.
In
that,
their spacesuits or out of their spacesuits?
No, not in their spacesuits. To smoke a cigarette in a spacesuit, that would be
tough.
Yeah.
Let's get to the question of sex.
Okay.
There's a great publication that you refer to in your book, and I looked it up on the internet. It's NASA publication 14307, 1792, and the title is Approaches to Continued Marital Relations in the Zero-G Orbital Environment.
It's the greatest hoax on the internet.
It was until you debunked it. That was during an actual shuttle mission, right? Shuttle 41?
Well, they just chose a random number, which turned out to have been an all-male shuttle mission. So clearly the positions and the things they were describing it would be anatomically impossible. But yes, that was a hoax. This report claimed that NASA had spent taxpayer dollars looking into the best positions in zero gravity on a shuttle mission, which is absurd.
How long did people actually believe this report was legitimate? Was there actually a window during which people thought this was true?
It still turns up in popular books about space. Mm-hmm. There's a book that came out when I was working on Packing for Mars. Another book came out, I forget the name of it, but the guy had reported this as though it were an actual mission, which is pretty lazy journalism.
And I don't know how much we can actually talk about this on the air, but the whole idea of self-STIM, as NASA calls it, being the accepted alternative to actual sex in space.
Again, I turn to the cosmonauts. it's just so much easier. I said...
Well, some of those Mir flights were how long? I mean...
Oh, yeah, 6 months and more. Valery Polyakov, I think... He was up there more than a year. He holds the record. Yeah. And Alexander Levakin, the cosmonaut that I asked about this, he said, my friends, they're always asking me, Alexander, how are you making sex in space? I say, of course, by hand. And he said, of course, sometimes it happens in your sleep. It's natural. It's just like, it's not a big deal.
Oh, you got to, I love those Russians.
Oh, yeah, you got to love them.
So soulful.
Yes.
The cognac.
Yes.
So earlier this month, a man from Inner Mongolia spent 2 days trapped in a latrine pit. You might have seen the story. I thought of you. Because I don't know how many weeks or months you spent researching the process of human waste elimination in space, but I definitely never imagined it was so exquisitely complicated. And of course it has to be, because everything that comes in has got to go out, and there's no outhouse in the capsule.
Right,
it's not like
you
go out on a spacewalk to do your business. So one of the most arresting chapters in the book is chapter 14, which is called Separation Anxiety. And you talk about an experience you had what's it called?
The positional trainer?
The positional trainer.
Yes, at Johnson Space Center.
Can you describe what the positional trainer is and why it's necessary on the space shuttle?
I can and I will. The positional trainer, in zero gravity, you're not sitting down on a toilet. You are hovering in close proximity. And so it's hard. You don't have the same tactile cues. And the opening is much smaller. It's about 4 inches versus, say, 18 on Earth in a regular toilet. So you need to get the angle right. And if you don't, you will gum up the airflow. The toilet works by airflow. It's sort of like a shop vac, because you don't... You don't have water flushing. You don't have gravity to bring the stuff down into the toilet. It's airflow. So you got to be careful. And so there is this, in the toilet bowl, there's a video camera facing up. And on the side, on the wall, mounted right here, is the display of what is being filmed, not filmed. Hopefully they're not actually
live
filming.
Action, isn't it?
Yes, it's like, it's closed circuit TV. It's closed circuit TV. And so there it is. So this is this... a view of yourself that you have probably never experienced and probably don't ever want to.
Are there a panel of people in the other room holding up cards that say 9.5?
Yeah. Very good, yeah.
Well done, Mary.
Well done. But it is, I was a little unclear on the concept at first. I remember saying to the engineer, Jim, I said, so the astronauts, are they watching like before they start or during? And he goes, Mary, you can't defecate on that toilet. It's only for positional training. You don't actually, it's just to make sure your angle is, you're like not too far back, not angling. It's just to make sure it's a positional trainer. Mm-hmm. There's a sign on the wall I love. It says, sit down on trainer seat and spread buttocks. Which is so
For NASA to have used the word buttocks must have been so difficult. I mean, these are people who took the E out of LEM, you know, Lunar Excursion Module, because it sounded too frivolous. It just became the Lunar Module. So it must have been...
I'm surprised they couldn't find a more anatomical word for buttocks.
For buttocks, yeah.
But good for them.
Yeah.
Good for them.
What were we talking about?
Don't ask me. We're talking about constipation.
I was going to say, sometimes they'll have the camera on for mission control. There's nothing going on in mission control, but it's just like the guys are sitting there, and there's some women now, and it is still like a short sleeve dress shirt, blue or white, pretty short hair. Yeah, it doesn't look that different to me. I mean, I haven't tuned in that much. Mm-hmm. But so JSC is still a bit of a...
Well, I just remember when I was down at JPL down in Pasadena.
Oh, right.
Yeah, they were all dressing up as Star Trek characters and having a big barbecue with Klingons and Vulcans. So not exactly...
Yeah, for me, perhaps a little different. I don't remember any of that at Johnson Space Center.
So someone did ask, is constipation a problem in space? And how long in advance of a mission do astronauts only eat a space diet? There's about two chapters of your book that deal with these two questions. It's kind of a tough question.
Well,
but,
the constipation thing is interesting
is a
because
virtue in space.
It was in all the way through Gemini and Apollo. You wanted a constipated astronaut because there was no bathroom. In fact, the food was designed to create a constipated astronaut. And there's that term. Yeah, that's in some of the papers. Up through the flights of Apollo, the main solution to waste management has been a constipated astronaut. That's a quote from one of the papers. Because there's no, I mean, you were just using a little, a baggie. You mm-hmm. were just kind of using a bag. You are your own dog.
Yeah, I can't remember which flight it's on, but how long did one of the Apollo astronauts go before?
It's Frank Borman on Gemini 7. He went 9 days. Jim Lovell said... There's a great back and forth where Borman's going, I think this is it. And Lovell goes, come on, Frank, only 5 more days.
He must have lost a bet on that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, this whole notion of how they deal with waste. What was that word you came up with in the book? Begins with an E. It's a great
Escapee?
No, we'll get to that in a second. We'll get to the escapees, yeah, in a second. But there's another word for
egesta.
Egesta.
The opposite of ingestion is egestion.
Egesta. Egesta.
So egesta. There are a lot of fabulous euphemisms over at the Ames and the JSC toilet engineering.
So in the old days of Apollo, they used these things called fecal containment bags.
What? Fecal bags for short.
Fecal bags. Yeah, and the astronauts had in using them. I mean. You really, it looked like it was took an extreme amount of coordination and an extreme amount of revulsion mm-hmm. at the same time to use them. And I'm going to read this one little...
It's from the report. Read the thing from that report.
I'm just reading 3 lines from, this is the report from Apollo 10.
Yeah.
Right? This is just 3 astronauts up in Apollo 10 and just 4 lines. Stafford. I hope I can say this on there. Okay, what was that word again? Began with an E? Ejecta.
Egesta.
Egesta. Okay, I'll paraphrase. Give me a napkin quick. There's egesta floating through the air. Young. I didn't do it. It ain't one of mine. Cernan. I don't think it's one of mine. Stafford. Mine was a little more sticky than that. To which Young replies, God Almighty. So you got 3 of them. You know it's got to come from one of them. They didn't bring a dog up there.
Yeah, because sometimes they wouldn't get the bag sealed quickly enough, and they had to put in germicide. They had to and mush it through. And I remember talking. Jim Lovell said when I was feeling sort of passive aggressive, I'd put the germicide in, and then I'd hand it to Frank and go, "Here, you do this. I'm busy."
It's a man. They take it all in stride, don't they? You know.
They do. They really do. They
It's the right stuff.
It's the right stuff. They're just. It's. I guess it's just sort of worth it for the prize at the bottom of the box.
On to that, of course. Any egesta begins with food, and you made a wonderful. You know, when I was growing up, of course, we had all these images of going into space, and we would eat food from tubes, and it was all this kind of tubes that looked like those little watercolor paint tubes you get in the. you know, the Blix or wherever you're going to go. And you made a wonderful point about those tubed foods, was that they violate two of the main intuitive requirements of eating any food.
That's right.
Which are?
You can't see it, you can't smell it.
You can't see it, and you can't smell it.
And the astronauts used to complain about that. And then Charles Borland, who's this retired food scientist, a lovely man, he said, I pointed out to them that a can of beer is the same situation, and they seem to have no problem with that.
Well, what are, obviously space food has evolved with the space program.
Yes.
What are some of the more elaborate meals being served on the International Space Station, and how would a certain meal differ from, what, say, the way you or I might prepare it at home?
Right, right. Well, they, Borland, that guy I was talking about, he's put out the astronaut cookbook. You can, which, you know, your pantry probably doesn't contain a lot of these ingredients. It would be like International Food Starch number 164-7 by Edom Food Corporation, sort of not your typical kitchen items. But the food has evolved tremendously. Now it's, I mean, Emeril and Rachel Ray have come up with meals for the astronauts. Of course, they are then thermostabilized. They are, you know, so they're, you know, they're basically germ-free. So, and the consistency is maybe a little different because you want it to, it's got to be pretty thick so it doesn't float off the spoon. Mm-hmm. You're sort of spooning it up, and it tends to be gloppy stuff that you could serve with an ice cream scoop, kind of. But it's in a bag, and there's various techniques for it. Some of it's dehydrated, some of it's just kind of gloppy, and you stick it, there's a little briefcase-sized reheater, and you put it in there. So it's changed tremendously from the early days. It was all about, first of all, low residue, very highly processed, no crumbs, so it was all little tiny little sandwiches that were then coated with this kind of waxy, greasy coating so there'd be no crumbs. And that, they were incredibly unpopular. And they would be rehydrated with your own saliva. You would hold it in your mouth for 10 seconds. I mean, they tended to fly into space and then fly back down because nobody wanted to eat them. Also, they didn't want to go to the bathroom, so they ate very little in those early space days, or tried to.
I'll interject here to say that you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. We're talking with New York Times bestselling author Mary Roach about her new book, Packing for Mars, The Curious Science of Life in the Void. So on a mission to Mars, that'd be about a year and a half. Is that one way?
Two to three.
Each way or round trip?
No, round trip.
Round trip. How long would that give us on the surface?
It's what, nine? It's 8 to 9 months each way. So you do the math. Yeah.
Wow.
Well, so because you've got to time it by the planet's positions relative to each other, so when they come, there's, you have a little window in which you can launch a Mars mission, and then, you know, when the distances are shortest.
Well, 9 months is about 600 meals per person.
Yes, right.
And that's a lot of food. Oh, are they going to grow food on the spaceship going up there? How can they possibly carry enough food for a crew of, say, five people for 9 months and have room for anything else?
Well, they would be growing food. They'd be, partially just because for psychological reasons, you would want to have something fresh,
something alive,
something
like
alive.
Plant,
yeah, right. So they'd be growing some. Also, you know, I suppose you could do caches. You could leave, like the Antarctic explorers, where you could send an unmanned lander and have things sort of there waiting. But the thing about food. Food is one of the big problems with the Mars mission. It's a lot of radiation exposure, cosmic radiation and solar, and food, because it's a, you know, hydrocarbons are good shielding. So you could line the capsule with the food and use it as radiation shielding. Well, of course, and then on the way back, what do you do? Well, you would be lining it with that same
Egesta.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, Pascal Lee, the director of the Mars Institute, has this quote that I can't quite say on the radio, where you would fly to Mars in a can of food and fly home in a can of Egesta. Only he didn't say Egesta.
You know, the problem, you make the point in the book, and it's really true, that the problem with all these wonderful scenarios of sending the food ahead and so forth is, you know, you send the food ahead and then you send the astronauts, and what if something happens to the food? So they've got to actually have double, they've got to have redundancy.
Yeah.
So whether or not they send an advanced thing of food, they got to send the food anyway.
There's this wonderful paper. I came across a paper from 1964 where there was a bunch of, it was called nutrition in space and related waste problems. It was a conference in 1964, and a lot of aerospace folks, there was this wonderful sense of kind of enthusiasm, and well, we're heading for the moon, so right after that we'll be going to Mars. We better start thinking about it. And they had one guy suggested making parts of the spaceship out of edible proteins, so you could eat the ship on your way home.
I love that.
That. And clothes. The windows could be sponge sugar. It was like a fairy tale. And one
ship lollipop.
Yeah. One of these, and one quite extreme thinker had worked out. He said, if NASA could find suitably obese astronauts, 50 pounds of excess weight, he calculated, that's 184,000 excess calories. That should be enough for the astronaut to live on for 90 days. In a sense, essence is saying, like, send someone fat and starve them.
Wow.
Yeah.
This is a crew of sumo wrestlers.
Yeah. Just thinking way outside the box. And then eating the box.
Let's move on to a totally different subject away from Egesta.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. I love that the kind of the attention that's been given to the spiritual aspects of being in space. I'll quote this line from a 2007 article in Wired magazine about the first Malaysian astronaut. Sheikh Mujibur Shukar has a problem. Mecca keeps moving.
Yes.
Now, you told me, or you wrote in the book, and we talked about it on the way over here, that Buzz Aldrin did communion on the moon.
Yeah.
He had some communion wafers and a bit of wine flung up with him.
A thimble full of wine, yeah.
I can't help
wonder. Because there's a little gravity.
There's a little bit
of
gravity.
Moon, a little bit.
So it can stay up there. And it says there's this, also in the same article, it says, when is sunset in low Earth orbit if you're experiencing a dozen sunrises and sunsets every 24 hours? When does Sabbath begin on the moon where the sun sets once a month? When is the first sighting of the crescent moon if you're on Mars? And the whole idea that if people are going to cleave to their religions, mm-hmm. there's going to have to be whole books written about dispensations for...
Right. There's the footnote. I don't know what page it's on, but some of the quotes from the... I guess it was a committee of imams came up with these guidelines for the practice of, I think it's ibadah, the five times a day, the prayers that are... It's supposed to be facing Mecca. And also, putting your forehead down to the ground, well, that's tricky in zero G. So they came up with this rules. They kind of made special dispensations. Like you could just raise your knee close to your forehead and that would be okay. And if you just face the earth, that's fine.
And you have to wash your hands before you pray and they can use handy wipes.
They could use wipes, yes. At least three, I think it was.
At least three.
Yeah. Okay. Wipes, yes. You could use wipes. So they had come up with a way to... Still stick to the requirements.
I thought there were some interesting spiritual questions and also some very interesting ethical questions. And one thing that really comes up in your book that, first of all, you do say one thing early in the beginning of your book that I think is the most profound thing you say in the book. It's a beautiful line. You say, space exploration is in some ways an exploration of what it means to be human. And you mean that both literally and figuratively. I mean, every aspect of the human body and metabolism has to be absolutely studied and understood to fly in space, but also what it means to be a human spiritually, psychologically, and ethically. And one thing that comes out in the book is just the way these astronauts, who we all grew up with this image of them as these tough kind of Navy and Air Force pilots, Army people, who would, more like John Wayne types, they actually turn out to be the ultimate conservationists because they will drink their own urine once it's purified. Mm-hmm. They'll breathe the same air. They'll just really serve as role models in a very different way from the way they have been. What are some other ways in which they?
Well, no, they for a Mars mission they would be extreme recycling. You would want to be reusing, finding ways. I mean, that guy who talked about eating the spacecraft was not all that.
It's a great idea.
It wasn't really that far off from. I mean, you really are going to have to think in that way, and also that just not adhere to the same psychological qualms. Because astronauts, they're the kind of person. If you say, on this mission we're going to be testing a rig, you'll all be drinking your own sweat and urine. They're just like, okay, so be it.
Bring it on.
Yeah. I don't know.
And that's what we'll all be doing eventually on this spaceship.
Yeah. So they are in a way sort of poster boys and girls for sustainability, and we may need to really listen closely to what they have to say. Yeah.
Let me end the program's last 5 minutes by asking you some of these questions more about your own writing career and the way you came to this arc. One question says, Mary, how did you know you wanted to be an author, and when did you first blend writing with science, blend science and humor in your writing?
I graduated in the middle of a recession with no job skills whatsoever. So I kind of fell into writing as one of the few things I learned in college. And I never really had this moment where I knew I wanted to be a writer. I started out as a copy editor and was very poorly suited to that because I'm not very detail-oriented. So I just started writing, and for magazines mostly. The science writing happened because I fell into a... I wrote for a magazine called Hippocrates, which is about medicine and health and the human body, and it was very a wonderful magazine to write for. Led to my writing for Discover. So it wasn't... I'm pretty passive. My career just seems to have happened by people saying, hey, would you like to do this? So an editor from Discover contacted me, and they were... hands down some of the most interesting stories I'd done, and I never went back to... Well, I don't always write about science, but it's my preferred beat. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, another question is, where do you go from here?
I am working on another book, but I'm not sharing the topic quite yet, but it'll be fun.
I'm sure it will. Let me ask you another question about the space program, your own philosophical idea. You know, there's a lot of conversation, especially with the economy being what it is, and all what it's always been since the 60s and the Vietnam War, and the moon race was competing with so many other urgent issues, that robotic crews or landers could do as good a job or even better than human crews, manned crews,
crude.
How do you personally feel about that, having written this book and spoken to the astronauts?
Well, I understand the argument that it's a very expensive proposition. But the things that I would point out, well, there's two things. First of all, I'd love Mars to be a global mission. I'd like to see lots of nations contributing money and expertise and personnel. And then the whole world can be sort of watching. And it would be an amazing, not since Apollo, I think, as the whole world watched something happen. The science side of it, you could do it. You could do it with rovers a lot more cheaply, a lot for a lot less money. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, you send a geologist, they've got intuition. They could just get there and look around and say, I know what happened here. And so, you could do it baby steps with rovers, but I don't think it's even about the science. I just think it's about the feeling that you get when you look at the moon and you go, my God, we sent people there.
It's a beautiful sentiment. I also wonder if something happened to that crew on the way to Mars after 250 days or so, if it would completely demoralize the human race from that kind of exploration.
That's hard to say. Yeah, there's that that speech, Richard Nixon, the alternative speech, that in case something had happened, if they couldn't get the guys back from the moon.
Mm-hmm. There was a speech? Did you read
There's a speech. It's on Boing Boing. I did read it, and of course I've forgotten what it says. But
sorry, folks. We'll try again.
There's been a problem. Yeah. and the other thing I point out to people is, particularly with a Mars mission, I mean, that whole... thinking outside the box, you would be just the technology that would result from having to, because you need a solution to, there's so many huge obstacles and problems that you end up with as technologies that really benefit us down here, and I think you'd have a tremendous amount of that.
We've become so risk aversive, haven't we, since the 60s in this country?
It's... there's that wonderful quote, we've got a couple minutes, the first flight was actually a balloon flight, the Montgolfier brothers. And on the occasion of this was 1780s, Benjamin Franklin was asked, what do you think of this frivolity? So what's the point of sending people up in a balloon? Who cares? And he said, well, you might as well ask, what is the point of a new baby?
Thank you, Mary Roach.
Well, thank you, Jeff Greenwald.
Our New York Times bestselling author, whose most recent book is Packing for Mars, The Curious Science of Life in the Void. I'd also like to thank the Lafayette Library and Learning Center and our audiences here and on the radio. I'm Jeff Greenwald, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned.